Hello everybody, Mark aka the Nerdy Punk back with you again today for a new video. Today's going to be a special video as it's going to be my top 15 albums list of 2018. So it is the end of the year, it's that time of the year, it's the holiday season. 2018 is wrapping up surprisingly very quickly and 2019 is just around the corner. So as I stated in my previous video, year-end countdown video, which was my Spotify top artists and songs list, this is going to be another one of my year-end countdown videos. So I'm gonna do three in total, I think, unless I come up with something else. One was the Spotify Wrapped. I'm gonna do my top 10 movies sometime in the near future, and then I've got the top 15 albums today. Now last year I did a top 10 albums, and that video didn't come out quite so good because of a lot of copyright issues. And so the audio got messed up because I had to block out a song that I used. And so because of that, I'm going to try to play some clips from some of the songs on these albums that I like the most. But I'm going to have to, you know, determine what is going to be acceptable for YouTube's copyright policy. So I may not tell you the exact song that I'm going to play, but I will try to play you a song from most of these albums, a clip of a song that I really, really like. So you got that to look forward to, but yeah, I'm gonna have to do some pre-planning before I put this video together. So that being said, this video, I'm shooting for the new year to get this up. So when you're watching this, it'll probably be around New Year's time. So hope you have or had a very Merry Christmas or a Happy Hanukkah, whatever you celebrate. I hope it was a great one. And I can't wait to get into 2019. It's going to be an interesting year. So, well, without further ado, let's go ahead and get into my list. As you can probably tell, if you're not familiar with my channel, as you can probably tell from my channel name, I am a fan of punk rock music. So you're going to see a lot of punk albums on this list, but not exclusively punk. There are some indie rock albums on this list, some blues rock, folk rock, lots of rock and roll. But there is actually one rap album on this list, so if you're into rap, you know, I threw you a bone there. So yeah, I can't remember if I've explained this already. My mind's kind of working in loops right now, but last year I did a top 10 albums, and I really, really liked that, but this year I felt there were so many good albums that I had to make this a top 15 list. Because I just could not cover all of the albums that I wanted to cover if I made this a top 10 list. So this is top 15 plus three honorable mentions. So let's get into the honorable mentions right now. The first one on here is the latest album from Passenger. Now Passenger made an honorable mention for his album The Boy Who Cried Wolf last year in 2017. This year he's back with another album called Runaway. Now, I don't think this album is quite as good as A Boy Who Cried Wolf from 2017. This album is more influenced by Americana music, by American folk, and I enjoy it, but I don't enjoy it nearly as much. But then again, every time Passenger puts out an album, I am going to listen to it. If you're not familiar with him, he is an English folk rock artist that I really love. He's famous for the song Let Her Go, which was all over the airwaves in the UK and the US in 2013, I think it was. Somewhere around then, that's how I discovered him. And that's probably what a lot of people know him for. But he's still pretty popular. His videos on YouTube continue to get millions of views. So, you know, the guy's making a name for himself. But yeah, he made an honorable mention this year again. I don't feel like the album was quite as good as his last one, but it was still a solid effort. And the guy puts out so many albums. He's put out an album every year for the past like 4 years, I think. So maybe it's a time for a little bit of a break, but you know, that's not for me to tell him. The second honorable mention is Snow Patrol's latest album called Wildness. There are a couple songs, the couple singles that they released from this album are fantastic. I highly recommend you checking them out. Snow Patrol is a band that has been in my life for a long time. I used to listen to them when I was really into like pop rock music, like bands like Maroon 5 and Train and Snow Patrol, of course. Their song Chasing Cars was one of my favorite songs for a long time. And I still like their music, and they just put out a recent album here. And I think it was good enough to make the honorable mention list. I don't think it was fantastic, but still an enjoyable one. Number 16, the final honorable mention, is Muse, the latest album from the English rock band Muse, called Simulation Theory. This album has been has gotten mixed reviews from critics. I really enjoyed it. It's very nostalgic. The whole album is like infused with 80s like awesomeness, and I really, really like that. They even had one of their music videos started out in like a knockoff Blockbuster video, which is so cool. So, you know, I really enjoyed the singles were by far the best songs on the album. The non-singles were not nearly as good, but I still haven't actually picked that one up on physical copy, but I do want to because I did enjoy it. And it's not nearly as good as some of their more recent work, even, but, you know, I feel like it's good enough to make an honorable mention. So those are the three honorable mentions. Now let's get into the official list, which is coming up with number 15, Kamikaze by Eminem. So Eminem is one of my favorite rappers, probably my favorite rapper of all time. I think he's also the best rapper of all time. The dude has an incredible flow. He's one of the best lyricists ever in any genre of music. Kamikaze is a response to all the bad reviews he got on his album from 2017 called Revival. And I thought that was an okay album. I didn't think it was great, but I thought there were some enjoyable songs. Kamikaze is incredible, though. This is like old school Eminem, except it's not, it doesn't sound like old school Eminem. But he's got that same fire and that same edge that he had from the 90s and early 2000s. It just doesn't sound the same. And I do prefer 90s and early 2000s hip-hop. I really enjoy that style. I think that's more catchy than what you hear today. But Eminem really goes after mumble rap in a lot of these songs. And I really like that because I think mumble rap is the most detestable genre of music in the world. I think it contributes almost nothing to society. It contributes nothing to music. It's just people, like, replaying a beat over and over again, saying random words every few seconds. And Eminem makes fun of that. He goes after it. He also goes after his critics. And in that case, in that fiery vocals, you've got like a resurgent from Eminem. So I'm going to go ahead and play a little snippet of a song, if possible. Eminem is a pretty big artist, so I might not be able to play anything. But if I'm able to play anything, you're going to see it in a minute. All right, moving on. Number 14 is Gorillaz, the Now Now. Gorillaz is a band that, first of all, it's an animated band created by Damon Albarn of the English band Blur. And then there's also an animator that works with him as well for the album, but the music is pretty much all composed by Damon Albarn. I've always been a fan of Gorillaz ever since I can remember. Their early stuff is pretty good. They really blend genres really well. They blend elements of hip-hop, electronic, rock, you know, all together to make this really strange concoction that's very, very catchy. And this latest album is very, very catchy. There's a song on there that they collaborate with Snoop Dogg, who's another one of my favorite rappers. And I really, really enjoyed that song. And I thought it was worthy of making its way to number 14. So let's continue on. Number 13 is the latest album from English rock band Arctic Monkeys. And this is called Tranquility Base Hotel and Casino. The Arctic Monkeys are a band that I've never really been that into, but their latest album came out and it was kind of like a shock to the world. This is like a ballsy move to put out this kind of record. This record feels like almost like lounge music, like something you would play in an elevator. And that sounds really boring, but it's actually not. It's really, really like moody and interesting, catchy. Yeah, I don't really know exactly how to describe this album, but I was in love with it for like a month this year. That you have to be in the right mindset to listen to this album, but when you, if you are in that mindset, I think it just like sets off fireworks. I loved this album for a long time this year, and would definitely recommend it. I think it's very underrated. It didn't get the best reviews and the best reception, and I think that's because a lot of people were expecting the kind of catchy, alternative sounding Arctic Monkeys, and they took it in a different direction. And I really appreciate when musicians do that, when they have the guts to put out an album that they want to put out, as opposed to keeping the sound that everybody wants to hear. So I'm gonna go ahead and play a song. Again, if copyright allows, real quick, of Arctic Monkeys, Tranquility Base Hotel and Casino.
Jesus in the base bar, filling out the information form.
All right, moving on. Number 12 is the latest album from English acoustic rock artist Frank Turner. It's called Be More Kind. I really fell in love with this album. I got into Frank Turner for the first time this year. I saw him at Warped Tour. He played an acoustic set in Indianapolis. It was one of like the four venues that he came to at Warped Tour. I loved that set. I've gone back and listened to some of his back catalog, and I really enjoy it. It's like if folk rock met punk and had like an awesome like melding together. And I really, really dig it. His latest album is more about how the world around him is just like falling apart. And that's something that we're seeing more and more in terms of music in the past couple of years because of a lot of things around the world. There's the rise of far-right, fascist-leaning leaders around the world, not excluding the U.S. with Donald Trump, of course. And the world, or this album is really just about the world and how we've gone wrong. And the sentiment is to be more kind, to be nicer to each other, to treat each other like human beings with dignity and respect, which is something that to me is shocking that we cannot do. We can't treat, like in the U.S. we have a whole thing going on with immigration, and it saddens me and shocks me how people are just able to like ignore the humanity of immigrants. Like just they think just because they may have broken a law that they deserve to be separated from their families, and it's not right. And I agree wholeheartedly with the message of this album. And with that in mind, I'm going to go ahead and play a quick clip of one of the songs from Be More Kind by Frank Turner.
Make America great again. By making racists ashamed again. Let's make compassionate fashion again. Let's make America great again.
Moving on with number 11, we have a very famous artist here. This is the latest album from Paul McCartney called Egypt Station. Paul McCartney's probably one of the biggest names in rock music. The dude is 70 years old and he's still cranking out awesome, awesome albums. Really, really had a good time with this record when it came out in, I think it was September. I've never been the biggest Beatles fan, but I certainly recognize their accomplishments and the impact that they had on the development of rock as a whole. It's, you know, astounding. They're probably the most influential rock band in the history of the world. And Paul McCartney, one of the surviving members, of course, of the Beatles, still cranking out awesome music. Egypt Station was a lot of fun, and I don't know if it was his best work. I haven't really listened to a lot of his back catalog in terms of his solo work, so I'm not super familiar with him, but I really did like this album, and I thought that it deserved a place in my top 15. Moving on to number 10, we have the latest album from the Smashing Pumpkins called Shiny and Oh So Bright. and then I forget what the rest of the title is. That is a long title. It has, like, literally, there's two more sections of that title. Shiny and Oh So Bright is, like, the beginning of it. This album has gotten very mixed reviews from critics. I think that most of the album is very catchy. I don't know if the lyricism is the best, but this is the reunion album with Billy Corgan and James Iha and Jimmy Chamberlin, three of the original members of the Pumpkins, back together to make a new album. This is also a very short album. It's only like 7 songs, but I enjoyed what I've heard. The first half of the album is much better than the second half, in my opinion. I really like the single Silvery Sometimes, Ghosts. And again, I thought it deserved a place on the list. Number 9 is the latest album from Trent Reznor and Nine Inch Nails. It's called Bad Witch. This was originally supposed to just be an EP. It was supposed to fit into the trilogy of EPs that started with, I believe it was, one of them was Ad Violence. I can't remember what the other one was called. Anyway, this was originally supposed to be an EP. They ended up making it a short album. It's like 6 songs. But it's technically considered an album, which is why it holds a place on the list. I think it's the best out of that little trilogy. And, you know, classic sounding Nine Inch Nails, very experimental, very industrial. And it's a sound that I dig quite a bit. So I may go ahead and play you guys a quick clip of one of those songs, and then we'll be back for number 8. Alright, next up on the list, number 8, is Father John Misty's album, God's Favorite Customer. This came out in the summer on Sub Pop Records. Father John Misty is an artist that I got into this year for the first time. He's more of like an indie rock artist. Definitely an artist that's like in his own mold. There's not a whole lot of people out there like Father John Misty. Very, very interesting. Josh Tillman is his real name, and he's had a band before. He was a member of, I believe, the Fleet Foxes. Sorry, I can't talk. And then I think he had a solo career, and now he's doing another solo career as Father John Misty. And to my knowledge, from what I've heard, this is his best stuff in his Father John Misty catalog. This album, I don't think, is quite as good as Pure Comedy. I prefer that album, actually. I think that's a genius record. This record is very good as well. It's really about his time living in a hotel. I believe it was a few months he spent like living in a hotel. Deals with themes like depression and loneliness, and that's something that I relate to quite a bit. And so in that way, I was able to form a connection with this album. The song Mr. Tillman on this record is very, very catchy. There's also a song called Please Don't Die, which is about his relationship with his wife. And that is a really powerful song that I recommend everybody listen to. So yeah, with that, let's move on to number 7, which is the latest album from the Scottish rock band The Fratellis. This is called In Your Own Sweet Time. This album I really enjoyed, and that's why it ranks pretty high on my list, but it does lack the punch of a Fratellis album to me. This is a more catchy, almost like 80s-inspired rock music, more like a power pop type album. The Fratellis are, you know, known for their kind of like alternative rock sound that has, a lot of their albums have a little bit more of a punch to them. They're a little bit more on edge. This album is more of like a clean flowing album. There are a couple songs that have, you know, a more edgy hard rock sound, but most of it's kind of a laid back sound. I'm gonna go ahead and play you guys a quick clip of one of the songs from In Your Own Sweet Time by the Fratellis, and then we'll be back for number 6.
The time just slips from your sugar plum lips, so I go there to watch it fall. And my jaw just drops when your cherry lollipops. I get nervous when you bounce my ball. I get the strangest sense. We were lovers past tense.
Okay, number six on the list is the latest album from punk rock band Alkaline Trio. Matt Skiba is back from Blink-182. He's back with Alkaline Trio, and they released their album Is This Thing Cursed this year in, I think it was late August. When their single Blackbird came out, I was all about that song, and then they released the single, the title track, Is This Thing Cursed? And that song, I think, is the best Alkaline Trio song in years. That is a very, very catchy song, a song that that I think has gotten widespread critical acclaim. Now, I'm not sure if the whole album flows together as well as I would like it to. It does get a little bit slow and tedious at times. I believe this thing runs 14 songs. And I feel like you can feel that at the end of this album. But there are songs in there that are just, like, exceptional. And as such, I felt justified putting it in at number six. Number five, we're getting to the really good stuff here. Number five is the latest album from the ska punk band The Interrupters. And this album is called Fight the Good Fight. This is their third record. The band, they're an older band that just, like, recently formed. Like, all the members are in their 30s, but the band just recently formed in the early 2010s, and this is their third record. I've seen these guys live twice. They put on an amazing show every time. So much energy and so much, like, positivity in their music. That's something that, you know, I don't necessarily gravitate towards. I'm more of a somber, like, individual when it comes to my art. But I really, really, their music is just uplifting to me. Makes you feel better about your life. You know, a lot about, like, hanging in there through tough times and coming out on the end a great person, or, you know, a good person. Their best song on this album for me is called Got Each Other, and it's they play that song with Rancid. And Tim Armstrong from Rancid is the producer of this album. He's actually the producer of all of their albums. And I believe he's had a guest vocal on at least one song in each of their albums as well. But that song really just about, like, camaraderie within the punk community and friendship and stuff. And that song, I fell in love with that song the first time I heard it. I had goosebumps thinking about what it would sound like live. I still haven't seen that song live, but The Interrupters are playing in my favorite venue in St. Louis in April, and I might see them then, and hopefully, fingers crossed, they play that song. So yeah, if that song is available to use for copyright, I will play a clip of it right here, and then we'll be back for number four.
If you are alone tonight, you can come with us. If you don't have friends or family, people that you trust.
Alright, number four is the latest album from The Dirty Nil. It's called Master Volume. Now, if I didn't pronounce that right, I'm sorry. I'm not a huge fan of this band, but I did just discover them. They went on a tour with Against Me a few years back, and that was before I was, like, a huge fan of Against Me. And they just released their second album, I believe. They're a pretty young band. And it's called Master Volume, and I recommend that everybody listen to it. It has, like, a hard rock punk sound that is very catchy. The lead single, I believe it was, That's What Heaven Feels Like. That's an incredible song. That's the first song on the album. Definitely recommend that. And all around, just, like, dirty, grungy, like, it's not grunge, but, like, you know what I mean? Like, a gritty sounding rock album. So all around, right up my alley, and it's something that I came into fairly recently. I think I first listened to this album way back in November, and this album came out in, like, I don't know when it came out. I'll have to look it up and put it in the description or something. But anyway, definitely recommend that album, and I'm gonna play a quick clip from one of the songs.
In a far off place,
right, we're into the top three. Now, throughout the year, this list has changed quite a bit. But the top three is, like, set in stone. Two of these albums have been in there the entire year since they came out. And then one of them was just added because it just came out in November. So, without further ado, number three is the latest album from Jack White, and that's called Boarding House Reach. If you know me, I'm a huge fan of Jack White's music. I love the White Stripes. The White Stripes is my favorite of his projects. His solo albums are fantastic. His work with the Raconteurs is fantastic. His work with the Dead Weather is fantastic. Jack White is just like an all-around great musician that, you know, has put out so many great albums. Boarding House Reach is no exception. This is a very experimental album, but Jack White is a very experimental person, so it's not a big surprise, but there's a song, there's a couple spoken word tracks on this album. There's a song that kind of leaned towards a rock or a rap side on this album. But overall, it's a lot of blues stuff. Respect Commander, which is a very bluesy song. That's my favorite song on the album. And overall, a very enjoyable album. I think it flows together very well. It took me a couple listens to get on board, but once I got on board, I was all about this record. And I think it's my second favorite of Jack White's solo albums. Still, Lazaretto remains my favorite. All right, I've played enough songs of that album, so if you want to hear any clips from that album, check out my review of that album that I put up way back in March. I'm not going to play any songs in this video. Instead, we're going to go straight to number two, which is the latest album, or the new album from Billy Joe Armstrong's latest side project, and that is The Long Shots, Love is for Losers. So this album, if you saw my Spotify Wrapped video, four of my top five songs streamed on Spotify were from The Long Shot. I love Green Day. I'm obsessed with their music. Ever since, like, I think it was 2015 when I first got into Green Day, and they've been my favorite band ever since. They opened me up to punk rock. I didn't even know, like, about this music until I listened to Green Day. And words cannot describe how much I love Billy Joe Armstrong. All of his music is fantastic. This album is just like a back-to-basics punk rock and roll album. This is very emblematic of rock and roll for me. Very catchy. I think the whole album runs like 31 minutes. Just in your face, you know, nonstop punk rock. It's almost like a Ramones set in that way. There's like no breaks. It just goes fast song, fast song, fast song. And I love it. I love it so much. So yeah, it's number two though. Again, I'm not going to play a clip from this album because I played a lot in my review of this record that I put up in April. Again, go check that out if you'd like. Instead, we're going to go straight into number one, which there's actually an album that I loved more than a Long Shots record this year, and that is, drumroll please, the new side project of Laura Jane Grace from Against Me. This is Laura Jane Grace and the Devouring Mothers, Bought to Rot. Surprisingly, I think I love this album more than I loved the Long Shots album. I have quickly became obsessed with Against Me. They're one of my favorite punk bands of all time. Laura Jane Grace is their lead singer, and she just came out with a new, well, sort of new side project. This side project got started way back in 2016, and she told a story when I saw her live about how this band started out as a Mountain Goats cover band, and she eventually started writing music and got enough songs together that they decided to put out an album. And this album is Bought to Rot, got put out in November on Bloodshot Records. And ever since I put that album on, when it released, I've been spinning it nonstop. I love this record. I saw her live in Indianapolis in November, right before the album came out. Fantastic show. In fact, I'm going to go see her once or maybe even twice on her spring tour. Probably going to see her in St. Louis, and then also thinking about seeing her in East Moline, Illinois, which is up near Iowa. It's about a 3.5-hour drive from my house. Yeah, there's not a whole lot more I can say. This is a, again, just a straight-laced, catchy rock and roll album. And I'm going to go ahead and play one or two clips from this record, and then we'll be right back to wrap up this video. Alright, so hope you enjoyed this video. That puts a wrap on my 2018 Top 15 albums. Again, hope you enjoyed. I hope it was fun, interesting. Go ahead and leave me down in the comments what your favorite albums were of this year, or if you're going to make a Top Albums video, I'd definitely be interested in checking it out. Overall, what kind of music do you like? What were you obsessed with this year? Any and all comments down below. Go ahead and hit that subscribe button to stay tuned for all the future videos coming up. I hope to have a very interesting 2019 on this channel. Life is kind of crazy right now. There's a lot of changes going on in my life, but I'm hopefully getting into the routine of things and can get a lot of really great content out in 2019. So again, have an awesome 2019 and have a great day. Bye.